When I first spoke with Pol Pot, he refused to take responsibility for an absolutely cataclysmic, catastrophic destruction of innocent people.
As the architect of a brutal social experiment driven by racial and political hatred, Pol Pot's regime left behind a tragic legacy of misery and mass graves.
No one had a clue at how many people had been slaughtered and how many people had died. No one.
On the 17th of April 1975, a guerrilla army known as the Khmer Rouge entered the Cambodian capital, Phnom Penh, victors of a five-year war against a government backed by the Americans. The Khmer Rouge leader was a man most Cambodians had never heard of.
When it was announced that Pol Pot, a rubber plantation worker, was the new prime minister, no one had ever heard that name. It wasn't until late 1978, when his picture began to appear in communal dining halls, that his own brothers and sisters realized that it was their brother who was in charge of this government.
Pol Pot was born in 1925 on a rice farm north of Phnom Penh in a Cambodia ruled by the French. At the age of six, he was sent to the capital to train as a Buddhist monk, but the boy from the village only felt like an outsider in the bustling modern city.
He didn't have a sense of the multicultural nature of the Cambodian cities like Phnom Penh, which were mostly ethnic Chinese and Vietnamese. Or if he did have that sense, he resented it. When he visited Saigon, he said he felt like a dark monkey from the mountains.
Cambodians' political culture is steeped in resentment towards its neighbors and its racial neighbors. It's steeped in a deep feeling of being a lesser culture. Pol Pot, in many ways, was a reflection of all of these things.
In 1949, Pol Pot went to Paris as a student. There, his innate racism would find expression in extreme communism.
The years that Pol Pot was in Paris was probably the most hardline Stalinist party in Western Europe, a very rigid doctrinaire party.
The terrible things that happened under the Khmer Rouge between 1975 and 1979 did indeed have a lot to do with ideology, but more to do with racism, with chauvinism, with nationalism. Those were the driving forces and the driving ideologies behind what many call genocide.
Pol Pot returned to a newly independent Cambodia in 1953 and joined the underground Communist Party. Outlawed by King Sihanouk's government, Pol Pot and his comrades fled to the countryside to wage a vicious guerrilla war. Even then, Pol Pot had his sights on ultimate power.
Pol Pot was more likely than not responsible for the execution of his predecessor as leader of the Communist Party in 1962.
He was a man who was able to hold on to power while eliminating any and all opposition.
Pol Pot's ruthless march to power was boosted in 1970 when the Vietnam War spilled over into Cambodia. Pursuing communist North Vietnamese troops across the border, the United States bombed huge areas of Cambodia, killing thousands of peasants in the process. This only increased support for Pol Pot's Khmer Rouge.
It was this terrible mixture of historical events and terrible Cambodian political realities which ended up with an orgy of mass murder, of which Pol Pot, without any question, was the architect.
By April 1975, Pol Pot's Khmer Rouge were in the capital, Phnom Penh. When they